Both of them black.
We do.
The ponytail. One, you guys. I meant to bring my glasses this time. I still did not bring my glasses.
Yeah, I was going to ask you to, I'm gonna after we do the intro, just pull Facebook up on your phone.
Okay, I'll do it there for a second. I'm about to see.
Guess we'll give it a minute.
Hello.
Hello, Mommy.
Oh, they're rolling in.
Taylor, will you give me a bottle of water, please? Thank you, pretty girl.
Oh, thank you. Okay. Oh, that's mine. I don't know what
you ready?
Mm-hmm.
We're about to start. We're giving everybody a chance to come in.
What'd you say? Okay, Nicole Knight says she forgot to call you, but she'll call you soon.
It's okay. All right. Cool.
Ready?
Yeah, I'm ready. My kids gonna drink up my little water. Okay, I'm ready. Oh, I'm about to turn this off. I'm tripping. He texts Courtney.
Hello, mommies. How are you?
Hello.
Please excuse all of this. I feel exactly how I look. How about that? This week's topic is postpartum depression.
Yes.
It's not an easy topic, I'm sure. But hopefully the information that Miss Kenyatta pulled will help everybody, hopefully. So we will get right into this. I believe we have, what's her last name? Courtney Carter is going to come on and talk with us as well about her experiences, her advice.
I don't think she's on yet. I sent her a message in her inbox. I don't think she's on. Stop clapping. Go over there.
In the meantime, have any of you mommies that are on now, have you experienced postpartum depression? Or would like to tell a little bit about what you know about it, or what you know it to be, or what your experiences have been with it? I know some mommies go through it with every single child.
What?
Some don't go through it at all.
Sure.
Okay, you wanna?
Yeah, I'm sorry. I can give my kids something to do. Okay. So, I know my friend Christine wants to come and talk about her experience with postpartum depression. Oh. She be preaching and singing in front of everybody. She don't want to come. But okay. I'm going to keep on going. I'm going to read.
And you know what, Veronica? Mm-hmm. That's a really good point. I didn't realize until I read over Kenyatta's notes, there is a difference between postpartum depression and postpartum anxiety.
Yes.
I didn't know that the postpartum anxiety was a thing.
Yes.
I honestly did not know that. I thought it was just postpartum depression.
Yes. Nicole, she's ready.
Nicole says, for about 4 years, but I wasn't aware. So, Nicole, you had postpartum depression for 4 years? It's just amazing to see to hear about the different timelines different women go through the postpartum depression. I didn't know that it...
Yeah, it's different things.
Lasts so long.
It's different stages you can go through. But I had postpartum anxiety. Remember I told you, I just always had a fear I was going to hurt them. Like, I was going to drop them, the back part would be too hot. Like, oh, I heard them crying. And it's just a lot. But Courtney is ready, so I don't know if you want to start with Courtney first and then I go over this. I don't know which way you want to do it, but Courtney is ready.
If she's ready, let's
go. Okay, I don't know how to put Courtney in. I don't know how to work that. I know you hit a button last time. And I think it's this button. Can I press it?
I'm scared. Hold on, y'all.
I think it's that one, yeah.
This one? No, that's to see the viewers. Hold on, people. And then invite group. No, that's to get people to watch it. Okay.
She's calling.
Tell her she has to log in and watch it first. And then we can add
it. Is she's not watching?
I don't know.
Okay, well, I guess I'll let you read on it. I'm going to try to get Courtney on. Unless you want to try to get Courtney on with my iPhone. I know you don't want to touch my iPhone.
What am I reading on?
Just whatever. I just highlight some stuff I thought that was, you know, stood out. Whatever you want to do.
I really don't want to do that.
Okay. Well, can you help Courtney get on? Okay. So, I went to Mayo Clinic and I found some information about postpartum depression because just wanted to come with some facts. You know, I'm going to talk about our personal experience of a postpartum depression, but I wanted to bring some facts to the table. So I'm going to do a little reading. The birth of a baby can trigger a jumble of powerful emotions from excitement and joy to fear and anxiety, but it can also result in something you might not expect, depression. Most new moms experience postpartum baby blues after birth, which commonly includes mood swings, crying spells, anxiety, and difficulty sleeping. And that usually begins within the first 2 to 3 days after delivery, and that can last up to 2 weeks. So the main thing with each stage is the amount of time that you go through it. And postpartum depression is not a character flaw or a weakness. Sometimes it's simply a complication of giving birth. And prompt treatment can help you manage your symptoms and to help you to bond with your baby. So I know it's a lot of stigmas, especially in the Black community, about getting mental health, but there's nothing wrong. Baby, I'm on live right now. Go sit down. There's nothing wrong with seeking help from your OBGYN or your primary care doctor or a therapist, because you don't want to suffer in silence or hurt yourself or hurt your child when all of that can be avoided. I'll stop talking when I'm recording this ready. And I went over some mood swings, anxiety, sadness, irritability, feeling overwhelmed, crying, reduced concentration, appetite problems, and trouble sleeping. Those are all symptoms of baby blues, which is normal, okay? So that doesn't last that long. It only lasts up to 2 weeks. But postpartum depression, those symptoms become more intense that I just named, and it's longer. Postpartum depression can last up to a year. She said she's had enough time.
Okay.
Whenever you're ready, I'll stop. Depressed mood or severe mood swings, excessive crying, difficulty bonding with your baby, withdrawing from family and friends, loss of appetite or eating much more than usual, inability to sleep, which is insomnia, or sleeping too much, overwhelming fatigue or loss of energy, reduced interest in pleasure and activities you used to enjoy, increased irritability and anger, fear that you are not a good mother, hopelessness, feelings of worthlessness, shame, guilt, or inadequacy, diminished ability to think clearly, concentrate, or make decisions, restlessness, severe anxiety and panic attacks, thoughts of harming yourself or your baby, reoccurring thoughts of death or suicide. An untreated postpartum depression may last for many months or longer. So it's important to seek treatment. And then there's another thing I learned this. I didn't know this till I did research. Postpartum psychosis. It's a rare condition that typically develops within the first week after delivery. And the symptoms are confusion and disorientation, excessive thoughts about your baby, hallucinations and delusions, sleep disturbances, excessive energy and agitation,
paranoia.
Thank you. Paranoia, attempts to harm yourself or your baby. Postpartum psychosis may lead to life-threatening thoughts or behaviors and requires immediate treatment. And this one, I did not know. This was new to me. Postpartum depression and new fathers. I did not know that some men suffer from postpartum depression.
Really?
Yes. That was news to me. Okay. I never heard of that before.
Okay.
New fathers experience postpartum depression too. They may feel sad or frightened, be overwhelmed, experience anxiety, or have changes in their usual eating and sleeping patterns. The same symptoms mothers with postpartum depression may experience. So that was news to me.
That's interesting.
Fathers who are young, have a history of depression, experience relationship problems, or are struggling financially are most at risk of postpartum depression. Postpartum depression in fathers, sometimes called normal parental postpartum depression, can have some negative effect on partner relationships and child development as postpartum depression and mothers can. So, when to see a doctor? If your symptoms don't fade after 2 weeks, if they're getting worse, make it hard for you to care for your baby, make it hard to complete everyday tasks, include thoughts of harming yourself and your baby if you have suicidal thoughts. At any point, if you're having thoughts of harming yourself or your baby, you should dial 911 or your local emergency assistance number for help. And also, here's some other options too. And I think I mentioned this already. Talk to your healthcare professional. I think it's 6 weeks for the checkup after you have your baby. Don't quote me on that. I think it's 6 weeks.
I think it is 6 weeks.
Call a mental health professional. Call the suicide hotline. And I'll remember to put these links in here after the live. 1-800-237-TALK. And that's 24/7. And there's Suicide Prevention Lifeline. .org/chat. So you can chat with somebody. Reach out to a close friend or a loved one. Contact your minister, spiritual leader, or someone else in your faith community. And how to help a friend or a loved one. If you're not experiencing postpartum depression, or if you know someone who is. So sometimes people with depression may not recognize that they're depressed. So people with depression, recognize they're depressed or acknowledge that they're depressed. And some people may not be aware of the signs and symptoms of depression. So if you have a friend or a loved one who's experiencing any of those symptoms, talk to them and try to encourage them to reach out and get help from a healthcare professional. And then I'll stop talking and I'll let Courtney go. Then I can pick back up.
Okay.
But I can keep going if I need to.
No, let's get Courtney real quick.
Okay.
Catch me in the midst of it all.
Hey, Courtney.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm good. Y'all are catching me in the midst of mommy duty.
I already know.
It never stops.
It's lovely. But this is punishment, so it's sad. Uh-huh. Oh, well. He'll be all right.
What you got for us today?
So, I know I'm seeming super perky, but I just wanted to share with you all my experience with postpartum depression and anxiety for me, and postpartum paranoia. That's something different.
Right.
My son now, he's 4, but I gave birth to him, of course, in 2015, and when I gave birth to my son, I was happy. That's how I was very happy. And he's so beautiful. He still is, but he was so beautiful. And even after giving birth, it didn't seem real. Like, giving birth and, like, waking up in the hospital after they give you all this medication to feel better, and the nurse is waking me up to, hey, you gotta feed him. I'm like, huh? Like, what? So, like, oh, this is my baby. I'm like, oh, this is my baby. Okay. Let me take care of him. And so I think it kind of had to have been maybe 3 or 4 months after he was born. The last time I know, it's in the thought that was like wrong. I don't say wrong, but things weren't right with me. Mm-hmm. And it was weird. I was like, this, I don't know. And you know, his father was there. He was very supportive. So, I mean, you think people say you have support, but it's still, it did not feel like that. Like, I still felt like helpless and lost. And I remember sitting not only at work, but in my house, because my house had really a really big back window, back door that had glass in it. So you can look out into the, you know, the sky or whatever, and I would just look and look out the window, look out to the sky, but it, and it's bright and sunny outside, but baby, it felt like it was storming. Mm-hmm. Like, I felt that. I felt that. And I tell people, you know, sometimes we say, oh, I feel like I'm depressed or I'm feeling depressed. Like, no. No. Mm-hmm. Like, that was depression. And didn't realize that's what it was, that no matter what I did, no matter what his father did, no matter what people around me did, I still felt helpless and sad and like I couldn't do anything. But I had this baby I had to take care of. I was fortunate enough to be able to be in a position to where I really spent the majority of my time with my son. He was with me. And I remember even laying in the bed sometimes thinking, something bad is going to happen. Like, something's gonna, like, something bad will happen, and I don't know what that is. I remember waking up in the middle of the night. I would wake up around the same time every night, like 2-3 o'clock in the morning, worried that either somebody's gonna come take my baby, or something's gonna happen to me, and he won't be taken care of. And I mean, I used to get sick to my stomach, like throwing, shaking. Having all types of convulsions because I'm thinking something's going to happen to me and my baby and I'm not going to be able to take care of them. And so, of course, I was like, you know, after, like, my mom passed away, I immediately went to therapy. So, of course, the first thing that I thought of was, I need to go back to therapy. I need to go figure out what's going on. Like, this is something different. This is a whole new next level of some stuff that I had not experienced before. And so, with going to therapy, I think I started like in that September after my son was born. And no, I didn't know. They didn't happen in September. It happened like a year after he was born. I started therapy because I was still in denial. And what I was going through affected like me and his father's relationship so like negatively because he was trying and doing everything he could and he was very supportive. And yet I was kind of mean. I was kind of evil. I was kind of going through it. And still wanting to shoulder everything, shoulder motherhood, shoulder all these things that I'm going through and not realizing that, hey, there's people around you that are trying to support you and love you and take care of you and your baby. And you kind of have to let them do it because otherwise you're not going to make it. And so I went into therapy and one of the things they asked me, I told them actually was, I'm doing this only for me, but for my son. Like, I don't want him to grow up being broken because I'm over here broken and not knowing what's going on. And I don't want him to be in the corner, you know, and affect him emotionally. No, I'm over here like zoned out because I'm depressed or I'm having an anxiety moment or a paranoia. I'm so glad. Thank God. Yeah. Thank God. Thank God for therapy. I had no shame with that. Thank God for medication because it came down to, you know, speaking with the doctor that day, we decided, you know, it was something I needed to do was to get on medication. And I still am on medication. You still need that. And it took me a minute to get used to that, to be like, okay, yeah. I'm going through this. There's no one to admit that I'm going through it. Because I didn't realize that's what I was going through until I realized I could not function. I didn't want to do anything. I didn't want to be around nobody. And I'm so thankful that I took it upon myself to go to therapy, get the help. And his father was very supportive of seeing people, talking to people, writing things down. And now I have my lovely little 4-year-old that I get to take care of every day. And we hang it out. But as far as advice, I'll tell people, like, please seek help. Seek a therapist. Never be ashamed. I've never been ashamed to go to a therapist. Like, no, when I need to go, I need to talk to somebody. And the person I talked to before I talked to a therapist was my mother. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, when she passed away, of course, like, now I got to go to a therapist. And one of the things that I think is so funny is that when I was going through this postpartum depression, that a lot of times I was find myself talking to my mother, Like, she's right here with me and having these whole conversations and just talking about how I'm going to get through and how we're going to take care of Carson and things like that. And so now, one of the big things that therapists talked about is talk to your friends about it.
Mm-hmm.
Talk to your friends about things that are going on so you don't have to shoulder it all. So I make sure that even though it seemed like I tell myself, I'm sorry, I'm not trying to be a burden. I'm not trying to be a Debbie Downer or whatever, but this was going on with me. So now I'm like more open to express what's going on with me and then seek that help and support. It has been so helpful over the past few years. Those are my shoes. Put them down. I'm just thankful for that. And I'm thankful that I'm not in that situation anymore. I wouldn't wish that on anyone because I know how that feels. And I know there's so many women in situations to where they might not be able to afford to go to a therapist or be able to afford the medication or things that they need for as far as them getting help. But if that's the case, I would say once again, just reach out to your family members, to your friends for support. They're free therapists. If you can't go, if you don't have the insurance, like your family and your friends are the people you can definitely go to, even if you feel that it makes you weak. It does not make you weak.
Mm-hmm.
It makes you strong because you understand that you need that help.
Right, exactly.
That's what I have to say. Do you have any questions?
Any questions? No. Well, thank you. I appreciate you for coming on and for sharing your experience with us. Enjoy your weekend.
I know. Go back to being mommy, y'all.
No. All right.
Thank you, Courtney.
Bye, thanks.
Bye, Courtney.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Okay.
Where to go? How? Okay, Nicole asked, is it true that most time your mental state manifests in the body as symptoms of being sick, like throwing up, fever, etc.?
Yes, Courtney, that is true. And I know that for three different reasons. One, I experienced it. Two, going to school for it, and I actually read it. It was part of one of my chapter reading assignments that I had to do. And it's in there, and it blew me away because I thought all of that was just made up in your head because that's what the doctors told me when I was experiencing it, that it was all mental, it was in your head. And then three, I went to therapy today, and my therapist told me that. It's a very real thing. Well, she was saying that trauma and things like depression, anxiety, all of that, it's when left untreated, it manifests itself in your physical body. So, like you'll have, there's people that have back pains for years, but never been in an accident, never been in any type of physical traumatic situation that would actually cause the back pain. But could have some type of experience, some type of traumatic event or something, or anxiety or something, and it left untreated and manifests itself in a physical capacity. And it causes those issues. I know anxiety, symptoms of anxiety, is hot flashes or chills, feeling nauseous, physically sick, throwing up, that sort of thing. Heart palpitations, headaches, migraines. It's a whole list of things that goes into anxiety. And I'm pretty sure that would still fall under the postpartum. I think those were some of the symptoms that you had for postpartum anxiety. So it is, it's a very, very real thing. It happens. It can happen. It's scary. That's why it's best to talk it out. Talk to other moms. This is what we're here for. Talk to other moms about their experiences and
how they manage to cope. Like, it's interesting to know that fathers go through postpartum depression. I didn't know that at all. I would have never believed that. Would have never believed that was a thing. I didn't know that it was a thing to go through it for so long, you know. And when I say long, I don't mean to, you know, say that you should be over it, you know, in a certain amount of time. But I mean, one of the moms was saying for 4 years she had postpartum depression. I didn't know that. I didn't know that that was possible. But I guess if it goes undiagnosed or untreated, you know, that it can stay a while and be a lot greater than what it possibly should have been. But I know you have more information.
Yeah, I'm going to read the rest of the information. Okay. Physical changes. After childbirth, a dramatic drop in hormones, estrogen and progesterone, in your body may contribute to postpartum depression. Other hormones produced by the thyroid gland may also drop sharply, which can leave you feeling tired, sluggish, and depressed. So just know you got a lot of hormone changes going on giving birth. And then sometimes people get on contraceptives. That's the more hormones. So give yourself time to get over those things. Emotional issues. When you're sleep deprived and overwhelmed, you may have trouble handling even minor problems. You may be anxious about your ability to care for your newborn. You may feel less attractive, struggle with a sense of identity, struggle with your sense of identity, or feel that you've lost control of your life. And any of these things can contribute to postpartum depression. Because we know those babies wake up every few hours to feed, and life still goes on. You still got work or what have you, or other children. So you can't just, life doesn't stop. Risk factors. Let's see. Any new mom can experience postpartum depression, and it can develop after the birth of any child, not just the first. However, your risk increases if you have a history of depression, either during pregnancy or at other times. You have a bipolar disorder. You have postpartum depression after a previous pregnancy. You have family members who have had depression or other mood disorders. You have experienced stressful events during the past year, such as a pregnancy complications, illness, or job loss. Your baby has health problems or other special needs. You have twins, multiples, or other multiple births. You have difficulty breastfeeding. You have problems in your relationship with your spouse or significant other. You have a weak support system. You have financial problems. Your pregnancy was unplanned or unwanted. And then some complications. Wait, did you want me to stop me?
That's a lot.
That is a lot. People have a lot of stuff going on.
Oh my gosh. And just listening it's to the lot. List. Just listening to the list, it's like,
it's a lot.
Had I not known that I was experiencing postpartum depression at the time, going over this list, it's like, yep, I had that, I had that, I had that. I was definitely depressed, I would say, with both of my children. I would not say that they were unwanted. They were both unplanned. They were not planned at all, either one of them. Definitely had financial problems. Definitely had problems in the relationship with the spouse. Mm-hmm. I could not best breastfeed with either one of my children. With both of them, I had great intentions. I started breastfeeding with them. And after about a month with both of them, my body just would not produce milk anymore. I couldn't do it. I was barely getting drops of milk. Like, I couldn't even line the bottom of a bottle. My body was not producing breast milk. With Jordan, I believe one of the doctors told me that it was probably the fact that I was 17. I was young. With Justin, it was that doctor who told me it was postpartum depression. I think, okay, give me a minute, Chancey. I lost my whole train of thought. I was getting ready to answer Chancey's question, but I definitely had it. I'm trying to think how
I don't think I handled it well at all with either one of my children. I did not handle my postpartum depression well at all because I didn't know what it was. And at the time, my support system wasn't what it is now. So I didn't feel like I had that support system to where if I wanted help, I could have gotten the help that I needed. Chansey asked, is depression and anxiety the same thing? I think I have what they call baby blues right now. Okay, so we did go over, which was new to me, that postpartum depression and postpartum anxiety are two different things. I think baby blues is really just a more socially accepted way of saying postpartum, whether it's depression or anxiety. It's just a more socially acceptable to say baby blues because it makes it sound like it's not as bad. Because as soon as you say depression, it's, you know, when you think depression, you think dark and gloomy and all of that. But when you say baby blues, you know, it makes it a little light, a little fluffier, easier to handle for people. But I would consider it the same. I don't remember what you read over the differences. Okay.
So baby blue, postpartum. That's not including depression, postpartum anxiety, postpartum psychosis. Postpartum is just baby blues. And then under that, you can experience anxiety. But when you start getting depression, you go into postpartum. That'd be postpartum depression. So you won't experience depression under baby blues, but you will. The common symptoms are mood swings, crying spells, anxiety, and difficulty sleeping. And that usually begins the first 2 to 3 days after delivery, and it only lasts up to 2 weeks, okay? But if you're experiencing longer than that, the next stage is postpartum depression. That'll be the next stage. And then, I'm trying to think when it starts.
Chancey, you just recently had your baby, right?
I don't know when she
had the last week or so, I think. I'm trying to remember Facebook posts where my days run together. I don't remember. I'm sorry.
So the difference is the length of time. So 2 weeks after birth will be considered postpartum or baby blues. But anything after that, we're going into postpartum depression. And then anything longer than, I think most, well, this, you know, everything's not 100% accurate. Everybody's different. But postpartum depression is up to a year. And then
1 week and 3 days old.
Thank you. Oh, yeah. So you got baby blues then.
Yeah. Right now you would technically fall under baby blues.
You in a 2 week normal range baby blues. Then I think up to a year, postpartum is up to a year. And then after that, postpartum psychosis. That's like when you're trying to kill yourself, you're trying to kill your baby. You know, that's, yeah. So, anybody else have any questions? Okay, she told us that. Okay. Did you have anything else you wanted to add while I'm back here?
No, not yet.
Okay, we did the fathers. I'm trying. Complications. Thank you. Complications. For mothers, untreated postpartum depression can last for months or longer, sometimes becoming a chronic depressive disorder. Even when treated, postpartum depression increases a woman's risk, of future episodes of major depression. For fathers, postpartum depression can have a ripple effect, causing emotional strain for everyone close to a new baby. When a new mother is depressed, the risk of depression and the baby's father may also increase. And new dads are already at increased risk of depression, whether or not their partner is affected. Wow. For children and mothers who have untreated postpartum depression are more likely to have emotional behavior problems, such as sleeping and eating difficulties, excessive crying, and delays in language development. That's a lot.
Wow. So, undiagnosed and untreated postpartum depression, anxiety, psychosis can cause... hold on. My nephew just woke up.
We're trying to keep the baby safe. So really, our mother's well-being can affect everybody in her household. So as women, we have to be sure that we take care of ourselves. We're nurturers and we're always taking care of our significant others, family members, our children. But we have to be sure to take that mommy time and to take care of ourselves and find a trusted family member or loved one to care for our kids if we can while we get a break. Look, we got a baby.
I got my nephew because I missed him. Mm-hmm. He just woke up.
Okay. don't know if you have anything you want to say before I go over to prevention.
I missed it.
Oh, what do you want me to go read all that again?
I'm not.
Oh. For the moms, I was saying that the postpartum, you know, affects the children and the father, the same with the family dynamics. So I think the mother that goes on to the kids will have, can have emotional behavioral problems such as sleeping and eating difficulties, excessive crying, and delays in language development. And I did notice that with my kids when I was really depressed, my kids didn't sleep or eat well. They did not. And that just adds to it.
And you know what? Justin didn't either. Justin still is a picky eater, but I had major issues with Justin up until he was 1-2 years old. So, I mean, this is a major eye-opener because thinking back, it's even when I thought I beat postpartum depression, reading this and listening to this, it's like, maybe I didn't. Maybe I went through it longer than I thought I did.
Mm-hmm.
Because a lot of these ring true. A lot of these ring true. And I didn't realize that it has an actual effect on your children. I know that, you know, our kids experience what we experience, whether we want to believe it, whether we choose to see it or not.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, to read it on paper,
it's
a major eye opener. So I mean, this is really one of the biggest reasons why we should take this topic seriously.
Mm-hmm.
If you just I know it. I'm trying to tell them that. So, if this is something that you are experiencing, or you think that you're experiencing, or you know someone who just had a baby, regardless of how long it's been, because it doesn't even have to be a new baby. Mm-hmm. Apparently, this can be years in the making,
mm-hmm.
and you can still be going through and not know it. It may not be this severe, but if you have any of these symptoms, then you would want to reach out and ask for some type of help. Like Courtney was saying, if you can't, if therapy is not in your schedule or not in your budget, I mean, reach out to other moms, reach out to friends, reach out to anyone that can just be a soundboard, a listening board, a mm-hmm. shoulder, just somebody to listen to. I mean, it sounds scary, especially when you get to the dark thoughts of it. You know, the dark thoughts when it comes to the depression about harming yourself or harming your child, or the fear of harming yourself or the fear of harming your child. And I know for me, I didn't think that it was okay to say those things out loud.
I was afraid, like, they're going to lock me up, they're going to take my kids.
They're going to take my baby from me, you know, and that's what I thought. I can't tell anybody. I can't tell anybody that mm-hmm. I'm scared. I'm a pull him too hard. I'm scared. Mm-hmm. I'm a pick him up too hard. I'm a break his neck. You know, mm-hmm. I can't tell anybody that, because if I tell somebody, they're gonna come take my baby from me and tell me I'm not a good mom. And lock me up.
Seriously.
You know, but it's normal. It's mm-hmm. it's okay, and it's a common thing. It's more common than what we choose to believe.
Mm-hmm.
And I know there's probably no statistics, there are too many T's in that word, on it, but I believe it's an actual big, I won't say bigger, because I don't want to downplay it for anybody, but I think it's a major issue in our community, especially because it goes untreated,
mm-hmm.
or not recognized at all.
Exactly.
And so, I mean, it's a silent killer in our homes.
Mm-hmm.
Because we just, for me, I know going through my moments, and I'm bipolar, so it's forever. It's not just when I had my children. It's any time that I experience a depressive episode, I'm categorized as being dramatic. Mika just being dramatic.
Because people don't understand.
Because it's not understood, or mm-hmm. it's not recognized.
Mm-hmm.
This actual issue is not recognized.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not okay. I feel like, for me personally, if I wasn't just thrown in the category of being extra and being dramatic and
seeking attention and all of that, then this is why I said I don't think my support system was where it needed to have been then for me to get the proper support that I needed, the proper help that I needed at the time, because I was just looked at as being dramatic because that's what I am. But it was real. Mm-hmm. I had very, very dark moments. Very dark moments.
That was one of the precursors. And if you've already suffered depression, or if you have bipolar disorder, that adds to it. And, or a family history.
Yeah. And Chancey, that's actually my exact diagnosis: bipolar manic depressive, and falling way, way deep into that depression. So it's like the postpartum part. So it's really big. It's really big. Make it a point. Oh, and if I haven't told you already, Chancey, congratulations. Yes. But make it a point to watch, keep an eye on all of those symptoms.
I'm gonna post the link
to this where we got all these, where Kenyatta got all these notes. We'll post the link, but keep an eye on all of those symptoms, because like it says, even if you already have the history of depression or bipolar disorder, it makes it an even bigger risk. And for manic depressive, I know that manic depression it's already a big deal by itself.
You're welcome.
But baby, you add this level, that's a whole, you don't want to do that. Don't do that. Please, 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 please. If I have to give you my number and you call me, wake me up if you need to, baby. If you need me, call me. None of you, not just Chancey. I know I'm talking directly to Chancey, but I'm talking to everybody. You are not in this alone. At all, period. This is a real thing. It is a serious thing. It has major, major effects on you, your children, your family, period. You should not have to go through this alone. And as long as we are here, you will not go through this alone.
My inbox is always open. I'm usually up anyway. Send me a message.
We can go. Where are we now?
Oh, I have one thing for Chance. Was it Chancey?
Chancey.
If your doctor's not aware, let your doctor know that you suffer with, that you were diagnosed with bipolar, is how I like to say it to my students, and that you have a history of depression, so they can be aware and they can keep a closer eye on you during this this time after you had your baby. Okay, so prevention. If you have a history of depression, especially postpartum depression, tell your doctor. I just said that. If you're planning on becoming pregnant, or as soon as you find out you're pregnant. During pregnancy, your doctor can monitor you closely for signs and symptoms of depression. He or she may have you complete a depression screening questionnaire. I completed that. I think those were my insurance. I used to have Ambetter before I started making a little money to cut me off. But they sent me a depression screening questionnaire afterwards, which I wasn't on this long because I was afraid. Right. But during your pregnancy and after delivery, sometimes mild depression can be managed with support groups, hence mommy. Counseling or other therapies. In other cases, antidepressants may be recommended even during pregnancy, okay? After your baby is born, give me baby fever. After your baby is born, your doctor may recommend an early postpartum checkup to screen for signs and symptoms of postpartum depression. So you don't have to wait to those 6 weeks. If you need to see your doctor sooner, definitely reach out to your doctor. And I'm sure they'll schedule you in. The earlier it's detected, the earlier treatment can begin. If you have a history of postpartum depression, your doctor may recommend antidepressant treatment or psychotherapy immediately after delivery. So that's all I have for my notes that I got off the Mayo Clinic. Just seek help and don't suffer through it alone. We're here for you.
That's all I have. I know that some people would rather choose not to tell their doctors about it, or like Kenyatta said, when she took the little survey, the questionnaire, she wasn't as honest on the questionnaire as she probably should have been due to fear. I know my issue was not wanting to be on the medications. I was like, I didn't want to be on medications at all. I don't think it touched on it in here, but
not 100% sure, but I'm pretty sure that there are different treatment methods rather than medication. Mm-hmm. You know, I know some people probably won't, like I said, want to go to their doctors because they don't want to be prescribed anything. I don't want to have to take antidepressants or antipsychotics or, you know, that sort of thing. But I honestly don't think that that's
psychotherapy.
Well, I think, is that the couch therapy?
Yeah.
I think that's the best. I will take couch therapy over any prescription. Any day.
And a lot of people do that.
Because it's more helpful. And, mm-hmm. Like with Jordan, I took, I was put on a bunch of different medications and I hated them because I remember I was on, I don't even remember what medications it was, but it was so many of them that I remember waking up in the middle of the night one night and Jordan was crying. He was laying next to me and he was crying. And I just, for about 10 minutes, I just sat there and watched him. I just watched him because I was in such a fog. I was in mm-hmm. such a daze from the medication. Like, I just watched him. And then it dawned on me, that's my child. That's mine. Like, because mm-hmm. I'm like, where's my mama? Where's, you know, my mm-hmm. granny? Why is nobody coming in here to get this baby? Like, whose baby is this?
Mm-hmm. And Courtney said that. This is my baby.
This is my baby. Mm-hmm. And after that, I was like, okay, I don't want these meds anymore. I can't deal with these meds because I was watching my baby cry and didn't even know who my son. I didn't even realize it was my son. Mm-hmm. I didn't realize that was my child. That was my responsibility. Nobody was coming because he was mine. Mm-hmm. After that, I decided to go off of the medications. But I think he's 13 now. I'm pretty sure technology and medicine has come a long, long way since then. Your forehead is in my way. Has come a long way since then, so medication is not the only option that you have when treating or, you know, trying to overcome postpartum depression. There are other methods, so don't let that be the reason why you don't consult a doctor or someone in the medical field, whether, you know, regardless of who it is. There are options. There are other methods out there. And it's very treatable. It's very treatable. It is curable.
It's normal.
It's normal. You're not the only one.
You're not crazy. You're not the only one going through this.
It doesn't mean that, like you said, it doesn't mean that you're crazy.
Not crazy.
It doesn't mean that you don't love your child or your children or anything like that.
You're not a bad mother.
You're not.
Or father. It doesn't matter. Yeah, you're not.
You're not. And I think that was one of the biggest things for me too. I felt like I was a horrible mother because of the things that I was feeling and the thoughts that I was thinking. Mm-hmm. I felt that I was both times. I felt like I was a horrible, horrible mother. But it's all a part of the depression. Mm-hmm. It's not reality. It's not true. It's not true at all. You are a great mother. You love your child, your children, and they love you back. Period. Can you get off my table, sir?
Come here,
I fight you.
Now my 2-year-old on the table. Move, okay. Son.
Does anybody have anything else? Any questions, suggestions, anything? Did you have anything about you, your experience, or?
Oh, yeah. Just kind of, I guess, knowing some of the triggers. I'm going to go back to that. I thought that was a really big thing. Having multiple triggers. My children are really close in age. They're 2 and 4. Jaren's about to be 3 in 2 months. So, multiple children, or multiple, multiple births, I guess, when you have twins or triplets. A lot of mothers feel bad. They can't breastfeed. Don't beat yourself up. That's why formula's here. Or having issues in your relationship or with your spouse or significant other. Those can be really big triggers. And money, because you got a whole new child to take care of. So just be aware of those triggers and reach out. There are many resources in the community. As far as, you know, if you don't have money for counseling, local churches. There are churches on every corner. Or even just
temporarily getting some kind of assistance. There's wig, snap, there's a lot of stuff out there, so just be aware of the triggers. Yeah, just being ahead of it, and if you're experiencing it, get help right away. The sooner the better. That's all I have.
No, that's not what I wanted to do. See what time it was. Jesus, okay,
it was an iPhone girl.
I don't know.
Oh, and let people help you. If you have people, a good support system, let people help you. Take the help.
Yes.
Take the help. You don't have to be super mom or super woman. Take the help. It doesn't mean you're a bad parent or less than me.
And if I don't think there's anything wrong with self-diagnosing. I mean, I would rather you diagnose yourself with postpartum and, you know, go seek help or, you know, talk to us or anything if you don't want to go to an actual doctor. If you think you have it, treat it.
Right.
Period. If you think that any of these symptoms match what you're experiencing, regardless of how old your child or your children are, if you feel that any of these symptoms match what you're going through right now, reach out. We are a village. That is not your phone, sir. We are a village. You have help here. This is, I think there's what, almost, there's 197 of us in here now. So you have 196 people that are rooting for you, that are here for you.
Mm-hmm.
Between all of us, there's a lot of experience, there's a lot of help, there's a lot of love, there are a lot of answers in this here village. You just gonna call? I love answer. I'm gonna give you some medicine, don't worry about it. There's a lot of help, a lot of love here in this village. Like I said, you are not alone. You're not alone. You're not by yourself in any of this. So, just, I mean, keep that in mind. Please, please, please keep that in mind. Through it all. Sorry, my nephew's banging on the table. I mean, I don't have too much more. If nobody else has any questions or any suggestions or prayer requests or anything, I think we can wrap it up.
All right, you guys. We love you. Be safe and enjoy your weekend.
Yes. I'm not in it.
Oh, you're taking care of the baby.
We love you. We love you. I really hope this helped. If there's anything that we missed, please let us know. You know, I have no problem, regardless of how I may look, I have no problem with jumping back on and filling in the blanks on whatever points that we missed. So just feel free. Feel free to let us know. We're working on next week's topic. Not sure what it will be just yet, if we'll do a poll or if we'll just pick one, but we felt like this one was necessary. There was no need to do a poll for this one. This was something that needed to be discussed. And we couldn't put it down on the list of priority on things to discuss. So I guess if there's nothing else, we will see you lovely mommies later in the week.
No.
Right. Take care.
Bye bye.
Bye.
Baby is awake and I love him.
Baby. And I love
him. My mom said we should pray. You want to come on live and pray, mama?
Yes, that would be awesome.
Come on in. How you go? Just click on this message. How do I get her in?
Oh,
we're going to bring you in so you can pray, evangelist.
I know. Hold on, we're gonna find you.
All right, we're gonna bring in Evangelist Hobbs so that she can do a quick prayer, pray us out real quick. I was actually thinking about that. Okay.
I thought about it before.
You gotta accept it, mommy.
Accept it and it'll pop you up. And we can get this going. I know.
You gotta accept it, mom.
It's in my hungry man.
Okay, now listen, can y'all hear me good?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Because my hair not done. Let me pray.
It's all right. Our hair ain't done either.
Okay, I'm gonna pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you on today, Lord God, for this open door of sharing of all the young mothers and women that are going through postpartum depression, Lord God, anxiety. And Father, we know that you are a healer of all things. And Father, yes, we know that we can get help and go to therapists and talk to different people and all these outlets that we have where we can help each other. But Father, prayer in the midst of everything can fix a situation as well. So Father, I pray right now in the name of Jesus that you touch every woman, Lord God, that's online tonight, and those that are not online, that are going through depression or anxiety, Lord God, and give them peace. Father, we pray healing and deliverance, Lord God, and Lord God, even for doors for them to get wisdom as on tonight, so they may be able to stay encouraged and know that, you know, everybody goes through something. There's nobody perfect, Lord, and that we're all here for one another. So just give us that wisdom that we continue to reach out and help everyone, because that's our calling as individuals, that we reach out and help the world. And it's such a blessing, God, that you've touched Kenyatta and Sister Barry to go out and just reach out to these young women and let them have a door and they have a way. And this is just the beginning of great things to take place. And we thank you for it on tonight in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 Thank you. Have a good weekend.
That was awesome. Thank you so much. I don't know.
All right. We have prayed out. The doors of the church are open. One inbox message away. Mm-hmm. If you don't have my number and you need my number, let me know. I am here. You have a village.
Yes, ma'am.
You have a village. Utilize your village. If you can't get to us, let us know. Between the two of us, one of us will get to you, whether physically or virtually. We will get to you.
Or maybe another mommy in your state. So
right.
Just reach out.
Let us know. We are here. Whatever we need to do. What's
on that? Oh, Lecrae, I'll find you. I love this song. This helped me get through. I'm a singer. It helped me get through.
You want to say something else?
Oh, you done so we can go? Okay, I don't really know how to work.
Finish. Just click finish.
Okay. Finish.